Hello, welcome to the seventh episode of the Ecological Dynamics of Skill. I'm Duarte Araújo, and together with Pedro Passos, we have been discussing skill learning in sport. Particularly, we have been interviewing key theoreticians, researchers, and applied practitioners who have been sharing their views about understanding sport practice and performance and how to improve it. In fact, the reality of sport is what has been guiding theory formation, the conduction of research, and the organization of practice from those advocating an ecological dynamics approach. Today, we have with us Dr. Shuttleworth, who is a highly distinctive applied practitioner informed by an ecological dynamics framework. Richard was a semi-professional rugby player who became professional coach. Since he met Keith Davids in 1999, he has been informing his approach to coaching through ecological dynamics. Richard worked at the Australian Institute of Sports as skill acquisition specialist across Beijing and London Olympic Games, as well as with the Australian and New Zealand rugby teams and coaches. Then he moved to UK, working for England rugby, including the England national team in 2019 Japan World Cup. We met in person in 2004 in New Zealand when Rick was starting his PhD. But we had already written a paper together led by Keith Davids titled Applications of Dynamical Systems Theory to Football, published as Proceedings of the Fifth World Congress on Science and Football. Rick, it is really a pleasure to have you with us. And I would like to ask you, how do you start to work with coaches and with sport organizations? And what are your key milestones when developing learning and performance environments in sport when you start these projects?
First, thank you, Duarte and Pedro, for inviting me on. It's a real pleasure, and I've watched every episode so far, and really, it's been a joy to watch previous people that I've met and respect, and thanks to Cypher as well. A true hub of world-renowned ecological dynamics. So I'm a big thank you to Cypher as well. And it's a pleasure. In answer to your question, Duarte, I think as a player, I played many different sports. I was always interested in the game behind playing. And I think that gave me an interest in coaching that I didn't really know at the time. But when I finished playing, I automatically went into coaching, and I always remember my first session that I had designed for my players, and I was still a player, so I was a coach and player. My best friend in Hong Kong at the time in the team, a New Zealander, said to me after the training session, he goes, "That training session was one of the worst sessions I've ever had." And I said, "Why? It took me hours and hours to design this training session." And he said it had nothing to do with the game. He goes, "I didn't make any decisions here in this training session that I would make on Saturday." So I think it was my first training session that I learned a big lesson. And this was a New Zealander who told the truth and spoke the truth. And from that day on, I think I started my journey into understanding coaching and skill development. It's at that stage I left Hong Kong and went to the UK and met Keith. And it was an enlightenment, really. I was enlightened by viewing how behavior would emerge. And there's different ways of viewing things. And that's what I really enjoyed, exploring different perspectives. So that was the start of my journey. And I really was fascinated in how to support coaches develop and design environments to help improve learning and performance. And so the journey started at Sheffield Hallam, at Manchester Metropolitan University, where Keith was. I continued on with my coaching whilst reading research. Simon Bennett, Keith Davids, Chris Button, there was a hub of researchers there who had come from different fields. And I think the thing about ecological dynamics was what my personal opinion was, that it provided you with a framework and concepts and principles and an empirical foundation from which to be able to use data or find data to support and then apply. And it didn't give you 100% certainty. I'd come from a grounding somewhat in information processing theory that provided a lot of certainty over what you should do and how you should do it. What I found with ecological dynamics was an element of uncertainty around how somebody should perform. And I quite liked that. I found that it helped me develop a better understanding and a relationship to find a better way of doing something. It was less constraining. And that was, I'm only a coach at that stage, so that was my perspective. And I think there was me and another number other academic students that were previous coaches who we created a little bit of a working group, and this moved to New Zealand and expanded. So I think I was quite fortunate, Duart. I applied these concepts in my rugby coaching at the time in New Zealand, with representative teams like Otago under 19s, where we did a lot of new types of training methods. And then this progressed to the Australian Institute of Sport with Australian sailing, indoor sprint cycling, kayaking, the Australian sevens team. And then I moved to England. And so the coaches I've been working with have been from young children's youth development right up to Olympic coaches. So I think one of my lessons I learned is these concepts and principles apply to all sports. And they do also apply to different levels of coaching as well. So if you go up to a more so-called elite coach, I think you will find that they're very good developmental coaches at the top level. They've learned how to explore and manipulate and create scenarios and situations. And also, I think the developmental coaches also can develop skills at the time they have to explore their environments. So I think there are concepts that you can apply all the way through the sporting system. I think that's ecological dynamics sort of gave me a real direction and a sense of purpose. And it's not to say that that's the only way of looking at something. I think the nice thing about ecological is you do appreciate and respect there's other ways of looking at things. And I think that very openness is very dynamic, hence ecological dynamics. I think it's very much about the coach and the environment, which is ecological, and the player. And then it's also dynamic. It's changing and it's evolving. And I think that's why I like these frameworks. We have many frameworks, don't we? In Chris Button's skill book, in Jai Chow's book, in there's lots of frameworks coming out from ecological dynamics. So it's a very rich, a very, very rich background, I think, which I'm quite excited about and still look forward to hopefully a few more years supporting.
Can you tell a little bit more about the work you did at the Australian Institutes of Sports and how you could present your views to coaches and to the organization?
Okay. I think when I went to the Australian Institute of Sport, Professor Damien Farrow and Adam Gorman and a few other PhD students were already there. They had an understanding of dynamical systems, not so much ecological psychology, but I think they understood constraints-based coaching. And I think when ecological psychology sort of morphed into ecological dynamics and it became a little bit more pronounced, I think there was an understanding that there was a different way of servicing coaches and a different way of using an integrated approach to support the coaches. I think Marty Rothwell, Keith Davids call this a department of methodology. I think this integrated approach is important for ecological dynamics. I think when you look at coach development and working with coaches, we need to discuss this from the outset. It's almost like a philosophy of your way of working. So I think working with coaches at the Australian Institute of Sport, they're not developed in a way to, at that time, to work with support staff. So a reductionist approach is used. And I think traditionally in these institutes of sports, it was, oh, there's psychology, there's biomechanics, there's performance analysis, and a coach would be left to try and create sense and find a way on how to make this all work. Mm. So it often came down to my discussions with Keith and Damien and also Adam Gorman at the time were more about joining the dots and how do you work with a coach to create sense? And I think people like James Vaughan talk about transdisciplinary and these sort of things. And I think these are concepts for an integrated learner-based approach where the athlete is at the center and the coach and the support staff integrate to find solutions based around needs and problems. So I think my personal approach at the Australian Institute of Sport was understanding the coach, understanding their philosophy and why they wanted to coach, and their style of coaching as well. Like why were they doing things the way they were doing it? Very much like how we work with players. And we were using an ecological approach with coaches. So I think that relationship was fundamental. The who are you? And then we looked at the why afterwards. And then a lot of the, you know, the strategies, the constraints, the manipulations, the interventions would sit on the back of this. And Australian sailing was a great sport to work with. I think they were well ahead of the time. Very open, very dynamic. The athletes very much respected their equipment, the environment. They adapted to weather conditions, and they almost viewed opportunities or affordances as potentiality of affordances, almost anticipating what may occur. So the planning for the sailors wasn't fixed. It was what was the plan behind the plan? It wasn't so much the plan, it was planning for a plan. And then anything was open after that. And then half an hour before any race, you weren't allowed to talk to any of the sailors. The sailors would ask you to just go away. And then that was them tuning themselves into the environment. And I learned a lot. And I think the sailors were one of those, Pedro, you surf, you know, and the environment is often uncertain and unpredictable. So the sailors very much are more creative in the way they look at problem solving. They're a very good awareness over their own capabilities and how to exploit situations. So therefore their equipment is very important to them. They spend hours tuning their equipment. They develop their own physique and their anatomy to change and periodize itself according to when they need to optimally perform. So I learned a lot with sailing, and then I think there were some other sports. Archery was another good one, Dwight. The Olympic coach, Simon Fairweather, he won gold medal in the Sydney Olympic Games. He never had a coach. He'd never been coached. Then suddenly he was the coach of the Australian team and I was working with him. So that was an incredible experience. You've almost got like a novice coach coaching an Olympic team. So that a completely different approach. We were finding ways to get athletes to explore their own techniques and become skillful in very short periods of time. We did an ecological dynamics case study on three archers who were the men's recurve team for the Commonwealth Games. They were all 17, 18 years of age, and they won gold medal in India. And high variability, constraints-based coaching. But what I think worked well was their openness to finding ways to solve problems using the equipment and using the environment around them and using each other. And because they were young enough, they were open enough to change. I think that possibly wouldn't have worked with more established athletes within the team. So socio-cultural constraints needs to be further examined. As well as performer constraints, I think, and having a look at an integrated framework that can bring this together to help support coaches is key. And so I think you have to adapt as a skill acquisition or a coach supporter or a mentor. I think an ecological framework provides you with a perspective to look at performance in a different way. And I think that's been it's been a real pleasure to sort of move along that track for me at the Australian Institute of Sport. And the final one, Dwight, was working in indoor sprint cycling with Anna Mears. The reason that was so enjoyable was my best friend in New Zealand who did a master's with a biomechanist. I've forgotten his name now, Roger, somebody at Otago Uni. The biomechanist, Nick Fliger, was the biomechanist for Anna Mears, the Australian sprint cyclist who beat Pendleton in the Olympic Games. Now, he was a good friend of mine and we worked together. So we already had an integrated approach between biomechanics and skill acquisition to support her to win the gold medal. Now, she had to perform a track stand start where you take the bike up to the curve and do a static hold of the bike where the cyclist behind you then can't hold it any further and she has to then go in front. So she wanted Pendleton to take the lead so she could sprint her out from behind. So it was just a great example with Nick, how we looked at different ways to look at adaptations and adjustments in the performance environment and start to look at different information to couple to actions and how we could manipulate this in an environment. And biomechanically, what markers and measures can we use to look at building a transformational learning environment where she built new stable behaviors which hadn't previously been there. So I think that was a really fascinating working relationship down in Adelaide at the sprint center with Nick Fliger. And it's funny because after that, Nick became the head coach. So he took all of this stuff he'd learned into the head coach position as a sports scientist. So you don't have to be a former cyclist or Olympic medal cyclist to be a coach. And so Nick now is the head coach with the new indoor sprint cycling. And so it was really interesting to see that occur. I've probably gone on a bit too long with that answer.
Fascinating. Well, now it's up to Pedro to continue.
Okay, Rick, I was delighted to hear your stories and all your background. And I have so many questions, which I really don't know which one I will start. But let me start this way. You told about an athlete who worked with you that never worked with a coach. So he learned by himself and he achieved very high performance, right? So my main question for you, and now let's talk a little bit about the rugby. And do we really need coaches in rugby, or the players can learn by themselves? It's just a provocative question. We know that we need coaches, but what coaches are needed for in rugby? Can you tell us a bit about your experience?
Yeah, great question, Pedro. It's funny, like when you look at young players who love rugby and they're playing in New Zealand in the park or in the backyard. I think there's a lot just to stand back and observe and watch. And I really think that the key skill of a future coach is to observe, just to watch, and be able to pick up how children or young people interact in a game with each other, with the environment, with the surface, with the time of day. And from that gives you the foundation to look at, well, I wonder what the role is of anybody who is an addition to that ecosystem. Mm-hmm. And therefore you start to look at things and think, they're already having fun. Or the game looks really good. They're scoring lots of tries. They're all engaged. They're immersed in this very dynamic game. And then often you start to think, God, I don't want to interfere with it. I actually might ruin it. So I think it's a different perspective to look at it. You could call it like backyard games. And I think Ian talked about that last week. If you look at that bi-directional approach that was discussed previously on one of your speakers, I think if you look at local to global rather than global to local, I think the players interacting create a lot of skills that sometimes are taken away from them when they go to their first organized session with a coach. Yeah, and I think I get quite upset sometimes when I see coaches trying to demonstrate their skills at the expense of taking these skills off players. which already have been developed, things like cooperation, emotional intelligence, self-organizing. So I really start to think that we need to relook at the role of the coach, not only the coach, but the role of the official, the role of the parent, the role of anybody who's part of that system, and start to look at how do we repurpose ourselves to support that game. Okay, if I think Pedro in answer, if we as parents or coaches start to think, oh yeah, they're going to join an academy or they're going to play for England, we therefore come down with a top-down approach, thinking, well, we'll have milestones now. We've got key performance indicators. Now it's my job to get them to this point. And I start to drive the system. Obviously, we know that there's a big danger in doing that too early. But I think actually, if we delay, we can still have this early diversification and an element of specialization at the same time, provided that we as coaches manage the learning environment in a way where the players are still at the very, very center of this. And their behavior is a reflection of the environment that's being developed around them. And I think that they need a big, big stakeholder in that as young people. I think we often take that power and that control off them too early. And therefore, their feel, this is only my feeling over time, is that they feel they can't affect the game anymore. So they feel like, well, why do I do this? I can't change anything. I'm not having an impact on the game. And that's because you've suddenly become a controlled component within a larger system, rather than them feeling like that they can develop that integration and interaction around them and decide the rules, change the rules. And I think that responsibility is given to coaches quite quickly, very early on. So the kids come on day one and often are very quiet, don't say a thing. They just wait to be told what to do and end up becoming like, you know, little robots moving around. And yeah, I think I've talked about that in many talks before, about this comparative coaching where coaches are comparing what's going on in front of them with where they want to get them to. And it's very dangerous, that, because it has quite adverse effects on the way that a young player can perceive how they are behaving and how they will respond next time when confronted with a situation. So I spent a lot of my time in that area over the last 20 years, not working with groups of coaches anymore. I prefer not to do that. I think in the last 5-6 years, I've gone to individual coaches, and I work on that basis. So I think in answer to your question, Pedro, yeah, I really think that the role of the coach and the official and the parent, how best to support the development of the young rugby player, is something that we can relook at from an ecological framework. And I think Keith may have mentioned this, I think in one of his talks, when we started to look at how organizations shape the learning and performance, socio-cultural historical constraints, I think, form of life. So lots of research in ethnographic and action based research methodologies, which are happening in with Patricia Patino, Martin Rothwell, Ben Stratford. So I think this is really important to support our look at the role of the coach, and using how best, you know, people are coached, taught, and instructed, because, you know, I think that the training methodologies are hinged on path dependency a lot. And I think that's something that we do need to re-examine. So, exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. So from what you just said, I think that, and something that we already discussed with the other guys is the role of the coach is somewhere in the middle between some kind of need to provide some stability to team performance, but let the variability of individual players, but also the collective variability of the team to adapt to the constraints of the match. Mm-hmm. So, but when we watch some coaching sessions, training sessions, often we can saw that coaches spend a lot of time practicing fixed movements, set pieces. And my question is, why? Is it useful to tell the players you must move this way and wait for the pass this way and need to cross this way? Is this useful? Because coaches still spend a lot of time on this kind of practice. And I want to know your opinion regarding this, because you work with the best coaches in the world.
Yeah, it's a really good question. And I think there is an inordinate amount of time, like too much time spent on trying to create certainty largely in a game where it's very difficult to predict what's going to happen. But I think the focus generally in rugby, in the more performance-based environments, there's a confusion, I think. I think there's a confusion that you think, okay, there's 30 players running around. We need to create some order in the game. And that's confused for structure. Mm-hmm. I think because we want order in the game, we start to think, well, we need some structures in there, which is a way of constraining decision-making and behavior to create what you want. Mm-hmm. So again, we're falling into this trap of planning outcomes and how the process should operate. And it doesn't take into consideration the nuances of the referee, the weather, the condition, the players. And so I think that structure has eaten in to a lot of this time where we get 15 players or 20 players together and we create an externally global to local organization of players to create certainty around us. So this reductionist approach, I think, has sort of dominated professional rugby when it went from amateur to professional. I don't think it went into professional necessarily as well as football did. I think that the first coaches, Pedro, as you probably would know in rugby, were very much forwards, very dominant characters, big physical front row characters who told people, let's have forwards and backs separated. Backs, you just run around with the ball, have a game. Forwards, line outs, rucks, everything that was structured. And then it evolved into, okay, maybe we should bring them together. Maybe we should do a bit of team stuff, 10 minutes at the end. Things have obviously gone a long way since then. But I think it has been dominated by a very reductionist approach that if you start to perfect these little pockets of the game and then bring it together, and then the way to bring that together will be to have your playmakers. So three or four players who run around the field who bring the bits together is still a reductionist approach. Mm-hmm. And I think it's not to say it's wrong. It's just to describe a way of the behavioral system in operation, mm-hmm. And the way it's being constrained from a more global to local rather than a local to global or bi-directional. So I think with the structure, you can periodize, you can plan, you can allocate time, and you can tick boxes to say, yes, we've done defense, we've done this, we've done that, we've done that. So psychologically, we feel prepared, we feel great, and then also the analysis plays a big role in that. So you can point the finger at something and say, well, we didn't perform well there, or it was because of this. It's not to say that's wrong again. It's just to say that these are rationales and reasons, I think, for rugby to operate the way it has. And I think if it goes down that too much in that direction, the ecosystem will create a self-perpetuating competition where you don't get outliers and you get the same problems facing you week in, week out. And it almost exemplifies playing even more structure to beat even more structure. Of course, those who are watching today who are from rugby know that there are some teams that play differently and throw different problems into those competitions, and that's where it gets exciting, or certain players will be a little bit different. But yeah, it's changing as well, Pedro. I think, the way we train now, there's a lot more, again, it's reductionist. They call it structure and unstructure. Mm-hmm. I personally don't like the terms, but suddenly you've got structure and then suddenly it's unstructured. And so they dedicate a period of time to unstructured practice or training. And then just watch the coaches and what they do during the unstructured, and then watch what they do.
Yeah, that the term structure and then structure that comes from Jim McKay.
Jim uses that a lot, and Eddie Jones. But look, I think it's not, nothing's wrong. I think my experience has been, try to understand what a coach is trying to say to you.
Yeah.
When they say something, it's not that they don't understand it. Try to get their understanding of what structure means. And often you're like, oh, wow, I know what you mean now. And it's not necessarily structure. It could be just a way to support decision-making or adaptive behavior, exactly. And they just call it that.
Let me ask you one last question that comes in the same direction that the question that was come from the chat and YouTube from Thiago André Rigon. And something that once Jim McKay told me, not all the players, and we'll talk about elite players, not all the players are able to accept these kind of approaches, these kind of ecological dynamics approaches. Some players, even the professionals, prefer to have someone who told them what to do, and other players don't. What do you think about this? Because Thiago asked this on the chat, how do you see the acceptance of the players for training methodologies underpinned by ecological dynamics? Is it easier to implement these ideas, or do you think that some players prefer that the coaches provide the solutions?
Yeah, it's a great question. And I think the beautiful thing about coaching and sport is that everybody's different. And that's why we do it. I mean, how boring would it be if every player wanted to be told, or if every player didn't want to be told, do you know? And I think the nice thing about sport is it's so refreshing, and it's all about interpersonal relationships and getting together and trying to be effective. So Jim McKay is one of the most experienced guys, and I know Jim quite well, and the chats I've had with him, he's been on a journey, and he's one of these honest guys that coaches through the player, and he doesn't coach at the player. And I think that's a very ecological way is to connect. I think Chris mentioned this before within the Maori culture as well, this interconnectedness. And I think Jim does that very well with his players. Mm-hmm. So I would imagine that he knows exactly what information to give to make someone feel stable enough, or when to maybe destabilize them slightly. Mm-hmm. And maybe to destabilize them, Pedro, you probably know that even in the England level, sometimes we give false information to see how somebody responds.
Yeah.
And that's destabilizing, of course, and it's quite dangerous. But then also you can say, look, I want you to do this. But I think the language is important, that you don't keep saying, I want. And if you give person one way of doing it, there's no flexibility for them to sort of shift away from that. So I think ideas coaching, I think Ludo mentioned this, that you can actually offer an idea. And I think Jim probably looks at things maybe that way, where he does offer an idea. How about we try this?
Yes, sir.
And then you take that solution to the problem. And then I think it gives a player a very high degree of oh, the coach trusts me, and I don't want to let you down. And I'm going to try and make this work. And so I've got a license now to add my own capabilities onto this. And I think that's very powerful coaching. So I think Jim McKay, and there's a number of people who you and me have spoken to over the years who will very much take an individualized approach to each player, but it doesn't mean that they have different collective goals. I just think it creates an attunement to this shared responsibility that I do need to change. So don't be afraid to ask for solutions from your teammates and your players and the coach, because together we'll work this out and find a way. And I think if you create that sort of culture, I think it moves away from the telling, and there's no need for that. You obviously don't have to feel the need to tell people anymore, but the players will be the answer. You just ask them. Mm-hmm. And the less questions there will be later in the season, then the more they're exploring and discovering. Yeah. And I think they're the best answer. on how well you're doing is the players.
No, no. Rick, we can spend the entire day talking about rugby here, but unfortunately the time flies. Duard, I think the ball is up to you now.
The time is flying, really. It's so fascinating, the things you are sharing with us. I would like, before we finish, to address a couple of questions from the chat. There is Susana Novaes Santos, and she asks, since you have worked with such different sports, what is the main difference when conveying ecological dynamics to individuals or to a team? How you see if there are differences in the way you approach when it's just one athlete or an entire team?
Yes, a very good question. My own personal experience, I started off with individual sports. And I think that gave me the it gave me the confidence to look at less complex environment. So there was only one person and maybe equipment and opponents. With rugby, team sports, you've got many different agents running around who are thinking lots of different things. So I think the principles exist for both, but the approach you would take for individual sports, it's a great question, and I'm just trying to narrow this down a little bit. I think if you look at the tasks involved, so from an ecological taught me very early on, rather than looking at things as closed and open, more than static and dynamic. So the information that an athlete needs to perform invariably in static environments, the less information and more information, which can be quite dynamic and changing in quite dynamic environments. So team sports are quite dynamic. There's a lot of information floating around. So the methods used for creating a learning system. I think Dominic Orth talks a lot about this, and I've talked a lot to Marcus Sullivan and people about self-organizing within teams. You've got to be very careful in terms of the information you deliver for teams to be able to self-regulate. And for globally to locally, I think it's really important in team-based sports to align your principles. Yeah. And then from local to global, as Pedro's research points out, from subsystems, looking at the control variables in teams from local to global, identifying them and having environments that manipulate things like, Pedro, correct me if I'm wrong, but we have looked at relative distances, relative positioning, and looking at velocity to regulate a performance goal in subsystems. Yeah. So therefore the skill of acceleration and agility become very important skills to regulate subsystems. So for me, I mean, that's very different to looking at, say, an individual sport. So an individual sport can often be very overly psychological and cognitive approaches, where sometimes you have to fight off that almost spending too much time on preparation and too much on preview, rather than actually focusing more on in action, information in the moment to regulate. So often I find myself trying to create training situations that create a need for them to use more local emerging information and be depending on that and less dependent on preview information, information before the moment. Again, the same is true for reflective information. Reflection after the moment it's okay, but if you put too much emphasis on that, again, that happens in individual sports. So they go through these big planning processes, which can eat into the ability of an athlete to adapt. So ecological has given me almost a toolbox of things like time constraints, where if you vary time, a lot of the spatial behaviors have to regulate and adapt. So I think individual sports, a lot of the strategies are similar, but they're used sometimes for different reasons. I haven't probably done a great job in answering that, but the team environments are different, and the culture is different, and individual sports are different as well, and can be quite overly technical sometimes in individual, but I think if we understand that techniques are just solutions to solve problems, then I think we can simplify quite a complex situation from an ecological perspective.
Indeed, I think you did a great answer, because you clearly point the things towards the task. And what is the task? It's maybe beyond if it's an individual or a team addressing that task. So it's a kind of consequence of what you are doing in a given environment. And all your reasoning helped into demystify this idea. If you are training with an individual, so you have to put everything inside of the individual. And that is not the case. The case is, is, I think you explained it very well. Well, we are running out of time. I told you, Richard, this is so fast. We would like to thank you very much for your participation. It's been wonderful. I think we could stay here more 2 hours easily, because you have such a rich experience. Next week, we will have with us Bruno Travassos, who will be more focused in futsal. And Pedro, I don't know if you'd like to do an update about the Congress of Sports Sciences we are organizing for July.
Update is that now, especially for the Portuguese coaches and technical exercises, I think that we can provide some 4.4 credits for the career of coaches and technicals of physical exercise. This will be updated in the website of the Congress very, very soon, because we just received this wonderful new one. Thank you, and we are looking forward to see you in the Congress. Rick, once again, thank you so much for this very nice chat, man. We can spend the entire day here. We need to schedule another one.
Oh, thank you for inviting me, Pedro, and to our, really enjoyed it. And it's lovely to see you guys together again. Lovely. Thanks.
Thanks.
Hey, cheers. Thank you. Bye-bye.